The Altai Mountains don't usually get much snow, but Awis tells me this year is a zut, a once-in-a-lifetime winter of extreme cold that buries the mountain passes in snow. A zut can wipe out a family's herds. But Awis can't wait for warmer weather. Most of his animals are pregnant, and soon they'll begin to give birth. He has to move now. These incredible horses are in their element. With a thick winter coat and a stocky build, they can break a trail through the deepest snow. But even for them, these conditions are exhausting. Awis is often out of the saddle. We'll ride nearly 100 kilometers, sleeping in rough camps and feeding the animals only the hay our camel can carry. I'm out of my depth up here, but my sturdy, stubborn little Mongolian horse knows what to do. By the third day, I'm sore and tired. Riding through deep snow over rough ground is pushing me to my limit. What I don't realize is this journey is about to get harder, much harder.
The world essentially getting to make this, which is completely lovely, but how do you... Essentially, how do you decide who gets to come with you, who you hire locally? How do you get access to all these people? That's probably too many questions at one time.
Okay, well, I'll go through them in order.
Okay.
Who gets to come on this trip? Well, we are a small team of filmmakers who know each other. And one of the people that is critical to making a film like this is Darren Donahue, who I have been shooting with since 2003. So I've been working with him since before I knew I wanted to be a filmmaker. And I because we know each other so well, we can really read each other's minds. But for a few films already now, it's been important for us to have two cinematographers who do different things and complement each other. So that's why at one time we worked with Mike McLaughlin, who left us here in Edmonton, and now we work with Aaron Munson. And so, you know, Aaron and I and Darren and I have been through so much together and you know, shared so many tents over the years that we really do trust each other. And it's important to have, I mean, you know, if you took certain periods of our lives, we spent more time together than we spent with our own families. So, you know, it's important to get along, right? And then we build out from there. And so, I mean, there are people in this room who I've worked with on projects because they have specialized skills that were important to bring in. You saw some slow motion footage there. That was shot by someone from Edmonton, now lives in Vancouver, named Luke Campbell, who has a phantom camera. So he came in.
You had a phantom camera.
Well, we used to have a phantom camera. Okay. It was only an HD phantom camera. So we needed a 4K phantom camera for this project. And that's not something you just find in every corner. So we had to actually find someone who had that camera and skill. And he came in and shot some of the stuff in the Equine Center and also the Kentucky Derby footage. We have a drone team who we trust. They're from Toronto. And they're very, very good at flying and framing. And so even though we fly our own drones a lot of the time for the specialty stuff, we bring them in. So So I think it's just you incrementally meet people, you get to know them, you become comfortable with their skills, and at a certain point you're ready to go on the big expeditions with them. And a lot of the stuff we do is expedition work. So you have to know that you're going to get along even when you're out there living in a yurt, dealing with difficult conditions.
The first time I watched the winter migration sequence, the one thing I thought was like, wow, this is really rough. Like, you were actually showing how rough it was, which is, you usually keep it together pretty well. So I was like, this must be really rough. And then you take a step back and you're like, must be even worse for Aaron and Darren. Like, they're carrying cameras and trying to do a winter migration thing. But Aaron did tell me he got to sneak away and drive in a truck sometimes, so he might have had it better than you.
Yeah. I mean, the winter migration, that sequence had never been filmed before. So in the case of our Mongolia sequences, we worked with fixers, experienced film fixers from the UK who know Mongolia, because we knew it would be so difficult to work by ourselves. And they did, for example, Human Planet. You might know the Human Planet sequences with the Eagle Hunter. Famous sequences that brought us these incredible images of these men on mountaintops with a golden eagle chasing. So I said to them, what? I mean, this looks like a really difficult and remote region to work with, but what could you never capture on film? What has no one ever been able to capture on film? And they said the winter migration. So I said, okay, that's what we want to do.
That's what we want to do.
Yeah, so you see some of the footage there is really jerky. It's because we couldn't take the camera crew with us. So I was on top of a horse with an A7S, like reaching into my bag with my frozen fingers, trying to get shots off, right, in the middle of it all. And so Aaron and Darren and the rest of the crew, we had this old Soviet army truck, this six-wheeled army truck. And it would drive down a valley and around the mountains and up another valley, and we'd intercept with him, and they'd get a few shots off of us on a tripod, and then they'd leave again, and we'd keep on going. And so they kept on going away and finding us again in that migration. And they had the worst job. They really did, because they had to sit in that truck for 12 hours at a time in the back of that goddamn truck. And it was cold and bounce along before finding us again. So I was on horseback. It was easier to be on horseback.
Interesting. it's actually, there's some nice editing in that sequence. If you guys haven't seen it yet, they're like just watching Niobe just be like, okay, this is wearing on me, and then you see the Jennebeck, who's seven.
Yeah.
And seven, he's just like, okay, here we go, bouncing along. And it's a nice contrast. And what do you do about sound while you're out there?
Philip Dransfeld was our sound recordist, and he was with us everywhere we went. Yeah. So he wasn't. So when I was filming myself on horseback, there was no sound. It was just me and my little camera. So I had an Osmo and I had an A7S, and pretty crappy sound and a lot of ADR back here in Edmonton. And then whenever the crew would find us again, he was the recordist.
Okay. Yeah. So you've got Philip, Darren, and Aaron in a truck.
Yeah.
And a fixer.
And a translator fixer, yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
And how did you find like Jennebeck and Awez and in the first place?
So sometimes we can rely on really experienced film fixers. This is only the case in some countries and some settings. But if you find fixers who've worked on documentary film, and I found a lot of these people through people I know at the BBC Natural History Unit, because they do stuff that's very similar to what we do, and they know the best fixers. These fixers are good enough to take your description of what you need and go cast in the field without you there. So in this project, they were the ones who had that ability. And so they went out to this region of Mongolia several times with a camera and essentially cast for us. And we were looking at five or six different families, sort of father-son pairs. And they sent this footage back to us, and we chose that way. So I hadn't been to this part of Mongolia before we actually brought the film crew in. And that was unusual. Usually I'm there doing that work myself.
Okay, that's interesting. And so this is kind of a broader theoretical question, but you end up as a subject within all your work. Well, not all of it. But
sometimes, yeah.
Yeah. And so how do you find that line between I am looking to observe the subject without having my presence and this crew's presence change what the outcome of what we would capture would be?
Yeah, well, this is a really interesting question that we filmmakers are always bringing up, right? Because the camera always changes the setting. It always changes the comportment of the subject. You can't avoid that. So my approach is that we're going to be changing the setting that we're filming. There's no real way to avoid that, and so you shouldn't set out to avoid that in settings like the ones we have in The Great Human Odyssey. It's better to be open about that with yourself and then form a relationship and kind of invent the scene with the subjects, with the characters you're getting to know. So what's important for me is to live relatively in the same way as the people we're working with. So in Mongolia, we lived in yurts. You know, of course, you do have all this camera equipment and you've got to manage your data every night and review your footage. And so you do have special needs. You do have a generator, for example. But in as many respects as possible, you're doing what they do. You're living the way they live. And I've done this in past projects. So for The Great Human Odyssey, I learned how to breath hold dive. For The Perfect Runner, I learned how to ultra run. For this one, I learned how to ride a horse. Trying to find ways to find a common language with people, even if there's a language barrier. And as that relationship develops, you kind of invent the scenarios yourself. And, you know, of course, you're trying to capture their way of life, the things that they do, and you want them to be as natural in those things as possible. But they're very aware the camera's there. And there's just no way of getting around the fact that sometimes you have to do things twice.
Yeah.
You know, sometimes you have, or you have to stop everything and let the camera get to where it needs to get. You know, that's unavoidable. But that's not verite documentary filmmaking. And if you set out to do verite documentary filmmaking, there's different rules. And I love working with those rules. The film we made about organ transplants that Miles knows, that was a situation where we really had to be as invisible as possible because it was life and death situations. We were in hospitals in very emotionally fraught situations. And so we developed a different approach. We never stopped anyone from doing what they were doing. We didn't have that power. Instead, we would mic everyone in a setting, monitor all those audio tracks, and run two or three cameras at the same time. And it was kind of a non-obtrusive approach to filmmaking, so almost never with a tripod. And it was our job to capture the moment as it happened naturally. So that's a different kind of filmmaking, and I love that kind of filmmaking.
On that note, before you switch back, I'm just curious, what I heard, I don't know where I heard it, but was that you literally just camped out in a hospital waiting for a family to say yes to letting you do this.
Yeah.
How do you open that conversation?
Yeah, so I directed a film called Memento Mori and Vital Bonds about transplant science, organ transplant science. And because we were aware that many films have been made about this in the past, and we weren't going to be making the first documentary about organ transplants, we set out to do something that hadn't been done, which was to have our camera follow the experience of making the gift of life. So that cliche that you hear all the time. So what that meant is we wanted to have our camera with a family that had consented to our presence before they realized their loved one was going to become an organ donor and capture that decision. And, you know, it sounds like a hell of an ask as a filmmaker, right? But at the same time, if you want to know about why we have organ donation in our society, you really have to understand that process and understand the motivations behind that process, that decision. So yeah, we camped in a hospital for 4 months. I mean, we didn't camp in a hospital, but
Aaron living. Was like, I'm on call. If something happens, I gotta go.
That's right. Sergio Olivares and Aaron Munson were camera and Philip was sound. And Tamara Kanu was the production coordinator. And all of us were on call all the time. I lived in my basement two floors away from the rest of my family with my phone next to me. And I would just get calls 24 hours a day from stars, from ICUs, from the surgeons working in the surgical theater saying, we've got this case. I mean, by that point, we'd spent 2 years developing a relationship with Alberta Health Services so they were willing to give us that access and make those introductions. And many, many stories that might have worked out did not work out for one reason or another. I mean, the plane left without us to go get the heart in Montreal, or we started a discussion with a family and then they decided, no, they weren't comfortable, and we just walked away. But what you see in the film are actual consenting characters who wanted us there, and we did capture that the struggle for life of a 28-year-old who eventually is declared dead and becomes an organ donor. And we follow the experience of his family and the surgery, and we follow the organs out to the recipients. And we did finally achieve that. And I think we did a good job of non-obtrusive filming, because we capture those incredibly emotional moments, but at the same time, the family respect us and like the film and are behind the film. They've always been behind the film, and we've done all of our media in the launch with them. So it means that that worked.
Yeah, no, it was, I ended up sitting right in front of them at the premiere.
Oh, God.
So it was very intense. It was
At the Garneau Theater.
Yeah.
Oh, it's an incredible moment. So if some of you may have been there, but it was Carl Nestle-Babchishin who led our camera crew in. It was Carl, the dad, who I talked to first, and he said in the hospital at the Royal Alec, I'm not in a state to understand what you're saying, when I was trying to explain why we were there, but I understand you've got a camera crew and I want Matthew's story told. So he grabbed me by the arm, by the forearm, and pulled me behind the curtain. He said, this is Matthew, call your film crew. We just want this story recorded, whatever happens.
Whoa.
And that's where the relationship began. So when you saw them, that was a year and a half later, and they stood up in the middle of the Garneau Theater. It was a sold out house, and everyone stood up.
Yes.
And turned to them and clapped and thanked them.
And then they're bawling, and it was a very intense moment.
I mean, what a thing for them to do for all of us.
Yes. Yeah. I wouldn't let anyone do it.
No, like, I don't think most people would.
Yeah,
that's not unreasonable. Yeah. But that's a different kind of filmmaking than EQUUS.
Yes. Yes. Okay. So back to EQUUS, and some of these communities you're in are so remote that even the concept of what you're doing has to be somewhat foreign. Like, mm-hmm. Where do you start with that?
Yeah, I guess sometimes when you're doing the kind of filmmaking that we do, which you could call ethnographic or expedition filmmaking, there's no way of conveying what you're doing with the footage. Even if they like you, and even if they see that you can ride a horse too, and you have that in common, there's no way of explaining that we're going to take what we're filming out to the world, and tens of millions of people are going to see your picture on a screen, right? So I've often thought about that over the years, and as the years have stacked up, more and more of those situations have stacked up in my past. And so I don't know what the next film is. We're kind of shutting our company down for the next 10 months, and I'm taking my girls out of school with my wife, and we're traveling the world, and we're going back to some places we filmed where we want to return the footage. One of these is a community in southern Philippines where there are free divers, the Bajau free diving people. And it's a very remote region because it's a war zone. So they're not really getting any messages from the outside world, and we're not getting any information about their world. But we were able to get a film crew into that place 4 years ago, and it was one of the landmark sequences of the Great Human Odyssey, and we think over 50 million people have seen this footage, and yet they have no idea.
Yeah.
Right? So we're going to go back to this place with this footage, Aaron and I, and show it to them and try to explain, you know, try to say thank you. This is what we did. We hope we got it. And we're going to do the same thing in Papua New Guinea with the crocodile people. We filmed a skin cutting initiation for Great Human Odyssey. Again, it's, you know, go up a river in a dugout canoe and then start hiking through the jungle to get to this place. And we're going back to Janabek, this little boy, next summer, with the short film called Boy Nomad we made about him and his dad, because we liked him so much we made a different film. And we're going to show that, you know, in the yurt to them. And it's not enough, but it's the least we can do, or it's what we can do.
It's what you can do, yeah.
It's what we can do. But it's a dilemma, I think, that filmmakers are going to face in all kinds of settings. I mean, there's never 100% informed consent. Because if you're not a filmmaker, you don't really know what happens with the footage.
Yeah. Even just like finding locations, I always find explaining to people what having a film crew in your house means. It's like, I really have to try and drive it home. And even then, they're going to just go with like, oh, no, it sounds really cool. And then they get it after they've done it. But yeah, it's true.
Yeah, it's a really difficult thing that you're asking. And I try to remind myself how difficult it is for people, because I begin to lose track of that. I mean, I'm around cameras all the time, and I'm in front of cameras all the time. And if it's your job, you begin to forget what a huge thing you're asking of someone, to let a camera into their lives and be themselves. I mean, you know, I still don't like cameras around my own family, because I know how transgressive it is, right?
Yeah, that's fair.
So it's a good thing to keep reminding yourself. You know.
Have you come across any situations where the language, or perhaps religious barriers, or just big gatekeepers that sort of kept you at bay? Or
well, the hardest access of all are institutions in our own Western cultures, I think. So for transplant, it was the health service. When Rosie Dransfield came to me and said, I've been talking to Alberta Health Services for 2 years, and they've said yes, I just said, okay, where do I start? When do I start? One of the films I dream about making is about firefighting, forest firefighting, because I put myself through university fighting forest fires. I was on those crews. We used to drop out of helicopters into these raging infernos, and it was so much fun. But forest fires are now really an issue, right? And they're going to become more and more of an issue as time passes. And there are films out there about fire, but if you watch them, you realize they're not really getting inside that culture of the firefighter, and they're not getting up close to the flames. But this is an institution. This is the forestry service here in Alberta and the firefighting service, and they just won't give us access. I mean, we actually had a film financed last year about the fire service, and we had to give the money back because we couldn't get the access.
Oh.
So I mean, you know, strange to say, but it's easier to get into a war zone in the Philippines than it is to get into our own institutions here at home.
That's so
risk averse. Yeah.
Yeah, I wonder if it's also like an understanding of, well, or the fear of being represented incorrectly. Like, we know what media is. We see it all around us all the time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I think there's a lot of irresponsible media.
Yeah.
And, one bad apple can affect everyone. So, you know, when you have media that push through. I remember when the fire happened in Fort McMurray, there was this rush of filmmakers from around the world to get up there. I mean, I even know a guy who took an IMAX camera.
Adam Sasky. Well, we know him too.
Yeah, yeah. But I mean, there were people coming from all over the world, and they were calling producers like me here in Edmonton and saying, how do I get up there? And you know, none of those filmmakers or media organizations managed to get very far. But it's that kind of an experience that makes the bureaucracy skittish, you know? And so the best thing you can do is to have a precedent like the film we made about organ transplants, to say, look, we can work with you.
Mm-hmm.
You have an agenda, you have a mandate, you have needs, and we can work with them. And we can be responsible, and we can have an agreement about what we do and what we don't do. But it takes a long time to reassure that there's just no incentive to be a risk taker in a bureaucracy. There's just a lot of incentives to be risk averse in a bureaucracy.
Yeah, that's fair. What was I going to ask you? I had a good question, but I went blank. So I'll take you on to our next sort of topic.
Mm-hmm.
what effect does having so many different deliverables put on the way that you make your creative decisions?
Yeah. Well, okay, what are the deliverables for a typical broadcast documentary? You will have a core version, which would be going to your anchor broadcaster or client. In the case of EQUUS, that was CBC 3 times 45 minutes. Then you have pre-sales. So in the case of EQUUS, we had a German version, we have a 90-minute French feature version, a 44-minute German version, 2 times 52 for one part of PBS, and 1 times 52 for another part of PBS. So it's a lot. What we decided to do was decide how much versioning we could take on and how much was too much. And so for the French and German versions, we found partners in Europe who were willing to essentially buy our footage and buy our rights to certain territories, and then they took on the versioning.
Oh, so interesting.
At the start of post-production, we sent duplicate master footage off to them on big RAID drives, and they just started editing those versions themselves.
Have you seen them?
No, actually, we're getting the locked version of the 90-minute feature film tomorrow.
Very interesting.
Yeah, yeah. But then we took on the CBC version and the PBS versions. And those are all television documentary, they're all essentially the same thing. So we were able to version with the material we had. But then we're making ofs, and everyone's facing this now. We've all got to make making ofs, right? So you have to be, it's like you have to be filming all the time. After you've finished filming your story, you've got to pick up the camera again and film yourself at night, you know? So this is something you have to get used to, is just always filming. And you have to decide whether you're capable of doing that or whether you actually need someone else on set to be thinking about that. Sometimes for complicated scenarios, we actually have someone who's filming the making of. That was the case in the Equine Center. The footage you saw of those beautiful horses, there was someone actually filming a making of there because it was too much for us to think about. And then we just get ourselves into trouble. We fall in love with characters and we make short films as allied projects. So we made a short film, a 20-minute film about Jan Beck called Boy Nomad, and one about the Indian relay called Fast Horse. And we made two quite produced documentaries about the music. You're going to see a piece of that at the end, and how we made the music, and then the cinematography challenges we had. So I guess you just make your list and decide what's too much. And I mean, I'm always wrong. It's always too much. But having said that, there's a temptation to take on too much. So for example, would you film a blue chip documentary and an IMAX film at the same time? I mean, this actually comes up as an idea quite often because you need beautiful images, dramatic recreations, big landscapes. Why not make an IMAX film? And we and other producers have toyed with this, but it's a bad idea because when you make an IMAX film, it's a different aspect ratio.
Yeah.
And your subject is in a different part of the frame. And it doesn't matter what your resolution and cropping ability, you still have to think for IMAX and think for television documentary. So that's a bridge too far for us. We've never done it. Some filmmakers have done it, especially with nature documentaries. But I find that the results are usually not very good on one side or the other. It's very difficult, if not impossible, I find, to make television documentary and feature documentary. You have to be doing one or the other. But that's more because, you know, a festival that would take your feature documentary is not going to want to know you've been in a broadcaster before they show it. And the broadcasters are not going to want the feature version of the film to go to festivals. They're going to want the first window.
Yeah.
So it's more that kind of a problem. I guess I could go on forever about that. But it comes back to what I mentioned at the beginning, which is decide what is the right amount to bite off. And don't cross that line. Or it'll come back to haunt you.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's fair. Yeah, go ahead.
So from what I'm hearing is you're very hands-on with a lot of the projects. So how does a person like you scale? I know in my day job, this is just a hobby, but in my day job as a software company, I scale up to 36 projects simultaneously. There's processes in place. So how does an individual like you take your talent, your influence, your achievements, scale to larger quantities, if that's where you want to go, or it can be done in film?
It can be done in film, and most production companies have the objective of scaling up. So they want to develop the capacity to be developing ideas while they're producing ideas and hiring a development officer. They want to have producers who are typically owners identifying ideas that their development team might be producing and then assigning directors they hire on to execute those ideas. They will typically want to do episodic formats that can expand to, you know, 8 30-minute or 40 30-minute. But that's not our objective. That's never been my objective. That's not what I'm here to do. And I think it confuses a lot of my fellow producers in Canada. We see each other, get together, have drinks at various festivals, and they don't understand why I'm still making one film at a time. But for me, that's the reward. It's the particular alchemy that I've discovered. I mentioned at the beginning that I decided I didn't want to work for another producer. I wanted to be my own producer. Well, I only produce films so I can be the director. That's why I do it. And I found that it's really nice to be engaged in the creative process of making a film and have the freedom to make financial decisions to support the creative decisions, right? I mean, when that shoe dropped, I was in Greenland and we were making a film about the origins of the Inuit. And I realized we could hire a helicopter and go out and film this landscape in a way we just are not able to do on the ground and in boats. And it would cost $4,000. And typically a director has to call the producer and argue for those $4,000, and the answer is usually no. I could just do it. And I realized this is why it's good to be a producer and a director. But that's not scalable. And then it's even less scalable because I'm on camera, right? So I can only make one film at a time. But there's a certain species of filmmaker that just loves making the films and doesn't want to be distanced from the creative process. And that's me. It doesn't make for much of an industry, but it is possible.
And to be fair, some of the best parts of the documentaries that you've made are scenes with you and you interacting with the environment around you.
Well, that's debatable, but I certainly have fun doing it.
Okay, I just want to go backwards because I want to know how you got access to Sable Island, because that for me was such a fascinating sequence. This is an island off the coast of Nova Scotia where humans are not allowed to go, and we actually have wild horses in Canada. The sequence is fascinating, the way that there's like... I don't want to spoil it, but I also kind of want to spoil it.
Yeah, go ahead, spoil it.
Okay, so basically, the reason... the reason these horses can live there is because these seals come once a year, have all their babies, and then the nutrients from them having their babies gets into the land, and the grass grows, and it feeds them, and they're good to go. But on two different sides of the island... You have on one side, like, the hippie commune side, where, like, all the horses are happy, everybody has what they need, they're not afraid of humans, they're not afraid of anything, they're just chill to go along. But then on the other side of the island, you have the whole hierarchy that steps in, because they don't have a still water source, so they have to dig for 20 minutes to find a water source every time they're thirsty. And as a result, you see a lot more of that combative, like, this is my hole, no, I'm in charge, I get the hole first. And so you kind of just want to like shoo the horses on the bad side of the island over to the good side so everyone can be happy together. But you're not really allowed.
That's brilliant. That was so good. Katrina did the described video for our film. So now I'm wondering, did she describe the film this way?
I did not.
You got the hippie horses and you got the assholes. that's great. That's Sable Island. And it was a great sequence. And the only wild horses on Earth are in Canada, on Sable Island.
Which is so cool. I didn't even know this existed.
Yeah. No, and it's a beautiful setting, and they're really funky horses. Sable Island is a national park, and it's a new national park, and it's one of those parks that exists to preserve ecosystem function, it's not for people. So people are not supposed to be there. And in fact, we're not even supposed to know that Parks Canada has people there. I mean, even that's even sensitive.
I think you gave that away.
That's even sensitive for Parks Canada, right? Well, there, you know, it was a bit of a negotiation. So we just hit a wall when we approached Parks Canada for access to Sable Island. I mean, no one goes on to Sable Island. They actually have these really expensive cruise ships that come, like, you know, small cruise ships, and 40 people will come onto the island for a couple of hours on a Zodiac, and they'll stand on the beach, and a park ranger will tell them about the horses, and then they have to leave again. And that's like that's the extent of the access. So we got to the point with Parks Canada where we said, look, it's really important for your social license, the Canadian support, the work that is done to keep this park operating, that we know about the horses. And so let's work out a way to do this in a non-obtrusive manner. And so we teamed up with another production company in Vancouver, Jeff Turner's company, that was making a five-part series called Great Canadian Year, which was made for the bicentennial. And we said, we'll shoot for two shows with one film crew, and we'll therefore have our impact. And then that went on and on and on. So this comes to the issue of you've got to go in person. So finally, I flew to Halifax and I walked up the hill. You know, if anyone's been to Halifax, you know the fort or the fortress in the middle of Halifax. Yeah. That's where the Parks Canada office is. And I sat down with them and I said, you know, we can do this and we can do this in this way, but we have to know now. And we finally got the yes. And so it took a lot of work and time. Eventually, we flew on in the middle of January. I mean, right in the middle of the winter. But that's why you go. You go in the middle of winter because that's when the seals are pupping. So you see this incredible nutrient exchange, right?
And they look so cute, but they're vicious.
Yeah. and it worked. But I guess I would say behind every sequence is a whole story of access challenges.
Yeah. No, that was a particular, like, I would, as a filmmaker, you must feel crazy privileged to be like, I get to do this thing that no one else gets to do.
Well, I mean, what happens actually is sometimes you have that feeling and then you realize, Jesus, I mean, I'm the one with this responsibility.
Yeah.
I'm here, I've got 3 days, it's a howling blizzard, and I've got to produce this sequence. It's stressful as well.
Yeah. Yeah. No, that's fair. Yeah. I just, Aaron described Great Human Odyssey. He was like, yeah, we'd be parked out in these places that people pay like crazy amounts of money to come safari. And you just get to sleep on the top of your truck in the middle of this park where no one's allowed to be. I was like, that sounds like a pretty good day.
That's one of the great rewards of film is that you get access and you get people in a different mode than a tourist can access, right? So what it does is it ruins you. Filmmakers are all ruined. They can't be tourists once they've been filmmakers because it's never the same for a tourist, right?
Yeah,
yeah.
That's fair.
Darren and Aaron never leave home unless they're on a shoot.
I think that might have to do with the fact that they're on a shoot a lot and they have to be at home at some point.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
But